if you ask me, the government is really, I think, the only patron that can do truly meaningful work, because there's such a wider context. If it's truly and authentically engaged, then there are no hidden agendas apart from the good of the city, the good of the people, the benefit of the program, and perhaps in the case of a more enlightened client, a larger benchmark. I think it's a rare phenomenon where the chief minister took a personal interest in terms of culture and in terms of the role of architecture and design in making a difference. And what he essentially wanted to create was an icon for the new Odisha that's rooted in its traditions and yet shows a way forward. The program, when it came to us, was very tight. Say the Krishi Bhavan is a building, already it was kind of visionary. It was not a building for bureaucracy, it was a building for bureaucracy and for the farmers. So this building was to be a bridge between the people who serve and the people who are to be served. We proposed that we expand the program to include the citizens. The government probably owns the best properties in a city. They're the greenest part of the city. And the regular citizens have no access to engage with that urban plaza. So we use that as a basis to actually lift all the offices off the ground and open up the ground plane and allow access and engagement at the ground plane level so that it becomes a small lung for the city. In India, we have access to craft at various levels. So there is an understanding of craft as what is done by master craftsmen or artisans in terms of certain aspects. But the simple act of hand making a building by an artisan is itself an act of craft. It doesn't require any special skill beyond what a mason knows to do. So I think there are various layers to this. I think the first aspect, being at a more simple level, is the idea of hand-making a building versus pre-casting or pre-engineering or pre-determining the end result. And the willingness to engage with that, it's a far more painstaking process. It's far less finished. If finishing is and slickness is a benchmark as an aspiration, because that's what you've seen in a certain context, then hand-making the building will not deliver on that. So the first is the willingness to be comfortable with what hand-making a building will give you, which to my mind is truly delightful. So to that extent, I see no reason why you wouldn't take that opportunity to allow that process to inform variety, to inform an organic kind of expression, which can only happen when someone is working at it at a certain pace with the hand. Maybe it's a romantic notion, but I think it's truly valuable in our context. It is the most sustainable form of energy, the human energy. There is no carbon footprint. But there was an opportunity for us to use the government as a patron. So the entire free-flowing public space engages with craftsmen in ways that they've not, in scales they've not worked with before. So it was a really nice experiment. So it is a storytelling device. And to my mind, it was fascinating. It was a process of surrendering yourself to what emerged and the idea of the emergent. And to that degree, I have to say, I'm very, very fortunate to have had someone like Sivanand Bhol, an architect who has committed himself to, you know, developing craft and engaging with craft. And he's from Orissa.
When it came to craft, which was a very important aspect of the building, and in fact a special tender process was created for the craft program. So we created a very detailed art and craft program, keeping all these facilities and activities in mind. We mapped what kind of craft can come where in an architectural scale, expressions on the wall, floor, expressions at different points. We wanted to create a contemporary narrative of Odia craft of the regional. we wanted to also create at a unprecedented architectural level, not merely serving as a, you know, smaller touch points. About 150 artisans worked over here and in different parts of Bhubaneswar and even outside Bhubaneswar to create interaction points. We worked with a local cast metal technique called Dokra. Created almost like brackets of the column using the Dokra craft. It serves as lighting points. In fact, some of the corridors have screens which has this metal cast technique built into it. We work with the local stones such as laterite and condolite. They're all soft stones and limestones available about 30 to 50 kilometer in the region. The lower pedestal area has been used with condolite and laterite. There are certain walls which has the agricultural crops carved into it. We use relief work into the soft laterite stone and created crop fields at a much larger level. In fact, some of the columns have been donned with laterite stone lattices, which are talking about the mythological folklore of the region. A couple of areas have Patichatra paintings as well, which is again a local technique. In the central courtyard, we have created a stone inlay in black stone. It's like a visual artwork, which essentially is a crop calendar, which talks about different harvesting cycles of Odia farming. The columns on the ground were shafts of the building for services. We thought of creating these larger to life columns, which has been done in condolite stone lattices. These were inspired when we visited Lingaraj temple and other historical areas. We picked up the architecture of it, the layered line work of some of the exteriors of these temples. Keeping the climatical conditions of Bhubaneswar, it is a hot and humid temperature. So in order to reduce the heat gain, we work with very simple techniques. So by creating deep recessed windows, by having a low window to wall ratio, by then creating the second louvered skin, we were able to reduce 40% heat gain into the building. Bhubaneswar experiences a climate which in the evening the temperature drops. So we worked out a night perch strategy for the building. It works with a very low technique damper system. So the idea is to bringing the cool night air into the interiors of the building. We created a lot of thermal mass with the stones and with the thick walls. The cool air at night gets stored in the thermal mass and then it dissipates during the day. So the idea was to not have the building completely air conditioned. Only about 20-25% of the building is air conditioned. Mostly the work areas are non-air conditioned. We wanted a building which is more muted, it is more humane in nature, which has the ease of access for people to come and be part of the building, to become part of the social fabric of the city.
The idea of familiarity and non-intimidation was also translated in terms of materials that are earthy and that age over time, and so that got us to use the brick, which is made of three soil types, and that is representative of the soils of Odisha. The Ikat expression comes from the textile traditions of Odisha, which are again so familiar. It is the idea of the weave, and the brick is a pixel, so it lent itself very well to the expression of the ikat. I think it is the most graphic part of the building, the most kind of obvious, eye-catching form, which gives it that identity. It's not referenced iconicism. It is something that even when a farmer walks in or a citizen sees it, they feel that it belongs here, and yet it's unusual. It is a signature of what new Odisha is. So it's a coming of age of Odisha and what Odisha could stand for and what modernism or a contemporary expression of Odisha could be like.